Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Neil Haley Show. You can check me out on Twitter at Total Tutor, Neil S. Haley, Facebook, LinkedIn, Neil Haley, Instagram, Total Tutor, Pinterest, Neil Haley, Google Plus, and also on Periscope at Total Tutor. Very, very interesting guest, and our next guest really talks about philanthropy and many things, so I'm excited to welcome to the program author Gene Shafiroff. Gene, thanks for calling. You're the author of Successful Philanthropy. Gene, I appreciate you coming on the show.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here.
Yeah, you know, tell me specifically how you got involved in philanthropic ventures. Was it something early that you thought it was very, very important?
When I was very young, my dad was a school teacher, and he was very interested in the education of the children that he taught. And then I went to Catholic schools for 12 years, Neil,
okay.
And the nuns instilled in us the importance of giving back.
Great.
And helping those in need. And so that began this cycle and my interest in getting involved in philanthropy and really the giving back process. And I believe that when you give, you get. And from there, I went off to college, and when I graduated from Columbia, I became a physical therapist at an inner city hospital, St.
Louis
Hospital in New York. And there I saw a lot of human suffering and people who just had a very rough time with health and finances as well. And again, that instilled in me the desire and also the interest in trying to do something.
And see, that's interesting. You talked about your years in Catholic school, Gene, and about giving back and helping the needs of others that truly need it, which I think we miss at times in this country. We don't see how very lucky we are compared to other third world nations and other places that just don't have anything, or even the people that are don't have a roof over their heads and don't know where they're going to be each and every day. Am I correct, Gene?
Yes, and I've seen a lot of suffering all around the world. A few years ago, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, I guess it was 5 years ago, I was in Cambodia and traveled and all over the country and went into an orphanage, and then I went into schools where the children really didn't even wear shoes to
school. Oh my.
Or flip-flops and left them outside, and they were all on wooden benches. And then I went into homes where we were helping to supply water wells because the people had no running water. And when you see how differently people live all around the world, you come back to the United States and you say, my gosh, we are so blessed. We have so much.
Yes.
We don't even realize what we have. And so, of course, we want to help. And so I think all of these life experiences, traveling, they help. And I think, taking children on trips like this
yes.
can also help to instill in them the desire to help. And just to give you a statistic, I live in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
In New York, one out of three children lives at or below the poverty
line.
So when you hear a statistic like this, you really want to do something. At least I feel very motivated and very interested in trying to do what I can. And of course, I can't do everything.
No, you can't. But you got to at least be able to do it. And I'm so interested in learning more about your book, but your story as well, Gene. Because, I had a really, really interesting interview with the host of The Wonder List from ABC yesterday, CNN. And he talked about traveling all over the world and just the shock. Like, you know, when he visited Cuba, he was thinking that, and this is going to be the one that airs on CNN on Sunday. He told me, and I was just blown away. He said that, you know, that he thought, oh, all the capitalists are ready because now the country's going to change. And literally, he was just shocked at what he saw. And that's what we have to look at when we go to these different countries, is how blessed we are to be in the United States. But also that we need to help others and whatever means we have or whatever resources we have, we need to do it either at home or outside the US, right? So that's what why motivated you to write this book is to show people that they have to leave a legacy in so many ways of helping others.
Yes, successful philanthropy, make a life by what you give. The book I wrote is all about encouraging and inspiring really everyone to get involved. And there are three ways that people can get involved. And sometimes people forget the importance of the time that they can give.
Yes.
Giving time is so important. And I don't think there's a person out there who could dispute the value of their time. And in the United States now, volunteerism is down. So we really need volunteers.
Yes.
And the second thing people can give is knowledge. You say you've lived a good life and now you're a little older and you have the knowledge of your life experiences, your work experience, your experience with your family, and that's very valuable. And then, of course, the third thing is the finances, and finances to give money. You know, you give what you can,
definitely,
you can throughout your life. And, of course, I say to someone, if someone's out of a job, this is not the time to give of your finances, but you can give a few hours, either a week or a month.
Yes.
Or even more to a charity, and you'll be so rewarded, because when you give, you get. It's a great feeling to give and to help.
Definitely.
Believe me, there's such a need.
There definitely is. And about giving time, give us some ideas of ways that we can give our time to others, to these charities and stuff, and how much they're in a need for volunteers, especially just let's talk about New York City and then all over the world, because just because you might not have the financial means, you always have specific time that you can set forth. Our parish goes to Appalachia every year, and I can't wait till my kids are older to be involved in certain types of things like that and get them out there, and even volunteering at soup kitchens. But tell us specifically some of the areas that you've outlined in your book about that.
Well, I outlined certain things. I mentioned soup kitchens. I mentioned maybe being a big brother or big sister to another person. That's so important to give someone the opportunity to have an older mentor, and of course you'd need training for that. And then there's just volunteering your desk work at a charity, and a multitude of things you could do. You can a young mother, or can be a class mother at school. She can get involved with the school, and that's a wonderful thing, because you're at the school where your child is, and your child sees that it's important to you to get involved. And one of the things I discuss in the book is how I believe it's very important to teach giving and to teach philanthropy.
Definitely.
And not only is it important for parents to do this, I think it's very important for the schools also to do this. So I would love to see courses on giving and courses on philanthropy, starting right from the nursery school, because I think that giving can be taught. And if you learn about giving at an early age, you will become a giver.
Agreed.
And I can give you examples of how a mother at home can help her child. Right from, almost from the crib, a mother can teach her child to be kind to other people.
Yes.
She can discuss that not everyone is as fortunate as they might be, and that they must care for those in need. And then later on, the mother and child maybe want to find a cause to get involved together with, find something that's interesting to the child. It might be getting involved with animals and working as a volunteer at an animal shelter, or it might be getting involved with a charity, which maybe has looking for a cure for a disease that perhaps a grandmother or grandfather might be suffering from. And these are all ways not only to give, but also to bond together with the family. So, I mean, there are a million different things that a family can do. And then as the child gets older, the child could get involved as a Girl Scout, Boy Scout, Cub Scout, and all of these groups have a giving back programs. They teach children in a very nice way how important it is to get involved in giving back and community service.
Yes, and you brought up a bunch of different ways. And first of all, giving your time is a big brother and big sister. I'm going to go back to the whole fact about giving and teaching giving and that volunteer process. But for people that are, in their millennial days or Gen X days, and they're saying, you know what, I'm listening to Gene right now, and I just say, I'm just not doing those things. Either I don't have the financial resources or I don't have the time. How do you recommend people getting started? Let's just say they want to start volunteering in the soup kitchen. I'm sure in the book you talked about that, how that process is to contact them and get started volunteering. But tell us specifically what you've told others and taught others to do to get right and to say, okay, I'm going to start volunteering in the soup kitchen.
First off, everyone has something that they can offer, and
Yes.
people are really, really needed. So I think sometimes people lack confidence, but you should not, because you have a lot to offer. And so what I suggest in the book is, I say, start with yourself
Okay.
and look to see what your passions are. What are your interests? If you're interested in maybe poverty, then you would look for a charity that addresses the issue of poverty.
Yes.
If you're interested in finding a cure for AIDS, you might want to look for a charity that is working on finding a cure or helping with people who have AIDS.
Yes.
If you're interested in, say, getting involved with your child's school, look to the school. So that's the first step. And then the next step is to look for a group where your passions might connect. So if you're interested in working with the school, you have to go
Yes.
to the local school. And I generally suggest that people try to find a local chapter of a charity that addresses their interests, because if you're involved locally, it's going to be a lot easier. Or another
Definitely.
thing people do is, instead of looking at what their passions are, they look to see where there's a need. Say they're in their community and they have a playground that's in desperate need of improvement. And so they may want to get involved with a group that's trying to improve that playground and restore it so that when children go there, they have a lovely place to play. So there might be a charity addressing that. And then finally, I say, well, okay, so you now know what you want to do.
Right.
You see there's a great need, and so you're connected that way. Now you have to do research on the
Yeah,
charity that
definitely.
you're going to get connected to, and that's very important, because you don't want to get involved with a charity that may be mishandling funds. And I must say that the majority of charities do not use funds incorrectly, but there are a few, and we read about them every once in a while, where the CEO of the charity is going on a lavish vacation. Well, you don't want to get involved
Exactly.
with anything like that, especially, I mean, if he's going on a lavish vacation and he's using his own personal money, that's one thing, but never the charity. So I recommend that a couple of websites that somebody can go on to look at, review a charity, and they are GuideStar and Charity Navigator,
Okay.
and they rate the charities, and I think it's really great to go to look at those websites.
All right,
Another
cool.
thing,
Yeah, we're going to take a real quick break, Gene, and when we get back, we're going to have more conversation with author of Successful Philanthropy, Gene. All right, you're listening to the Total Education Network and watching The Neil Haley Show, and we'll be back in just a moment.
Hello, my name is John Bauer. I'm a paramedic supervisor with Tri-Community South EMS. I would like to tell you about hands-only CPR. If you see a teen or adult collapse, call or have someone call 911. Bare the victim's chest. Place one hand on the center of the chest and interlock both hands. Compress the chest fast and hard. Press 100 times a minute to the beat of the song Staying Alive. This will give you the correct rate for your compressions. Do this until EMS arrives. stop CPR if you were too exhausted to continue. These two simple steps can double the person's chance for survival. Doing these steps can mean the difference between life and death. For more information on CPR training or our speakers bureau, go to tcsems.org or call 412-831-3710.
We're back to the Neil Haley Show, and I'm enjoying the conversation I'm having with Jean about her book and philanthropy in general, and looking at just specifically what philanthropic ventures. And Jean, you're pretty much calling everyone to this. It doesn't matter what age, person they are, they can do this, right? To help make our planet a better place, correct?
Absolutely, because we want everyone involved, and there is a great need, and everyone has something to offer, regardless of age or socioeconomic situation. Everyone is needed, and everyone can do great work, truly.
They definitely can.
You know, one of the millennials, working people, stay-at-home mothers, and then the retirees and empty nesters are all very, very important to the this. And my book addresses all groups.
Would you say I missed that last thing?
My group addresses all groups. It's
for all groups. Okay.
I even think my book would be a textbook in high schools and then colleges, and it would be an easy read or a required reading book, because I think there's a lot to gain from it. So the other things I go over in the book, I talk about if someone's thinking of joining a charity board, well, these are the things that charity boards look for in people, and sort of the responsibilities that someone might have if they're on a board. I talk about if you're thinking of starting your own charity, well, these are things you ought to consider very seriously before you do it, because running a charity is just like running a business.
It is, yeah.
And then it really is. It's, you know, you have to have a profit and loss statement and really watch that. You're under government scrutiny in the United States, and you're required to file a 990 form with the U.S. government. And so you want to be 100% on board if you start a charity. And then I also talk about how people now you've decided to volunteer for a charity. Well, how should you be treated as a volunteer? And how do you treat those around you? And that's very important, because everyone has to be treated well.
I was going to say, Jean, I wanted to jump back to starting a foundation or charity. It's very interesting. I interview a lot of former NFL athletes, NBA athletes, certain people starting foundations, and how they have to understand it's definitely a business. I was on a board of one, and I saw how crazy the board meetings were and how everything had to be to a T and to make sure that the money is spent, because it's a nonprofit, you know, a foundation or charity. So once you say, you know, I have a friend right now that wrote a book called Grady Gets Glasses, and she's looking to maybe start a foundation at one point to get glasses to kids all over the world that don't have glasses. The process of starting a foundation charity, give us some of those steps to get started in that process once you think, I want to do this.
Whether you should start a charity, or and you should also research to see if someone else has a charity that's doing the same thing that you might want to do, because there's a lot of duplication. So going back to your friend who wants to provide eyeglasses to children and around the world, there may be another charity that's doing the same thing, and if they're doing a very good job, it might be best for her to get involved with them.
Yes, so that's one thing
definitely. To think about. But once you've decided that you've come up with an idea and it fills a niche that's needed, that fills a need, and you don't think anyone is doing that, or you think you can do it better, Well, the next thing you do is you have to apply for 501c3 status with the government here in
yes.
the United States, and it's a lengthy process.
It doesn't take for it takes longer than you think. Yeah.
I'm not sure how long it takes, but I know it can be lengthy, and then you have to say, okay, I guess unless you're an accountant, you
yeah.
have to hire an accountant to help you with your books, and
mm-hmm.
You may want to do everything on a volunteer basis, where you volunteer your time since your charity will be small. But some of the things you should think about is, well, if you're starting a charity, there's a ratio for all charities, and that is that in general, 20% of your revenue should go towards your overhead, only 20% or less.
Okay.
The rest needs to go to program activities. And that 20-80 ratio is really very important, because people mm-hmm. don't want to give to a charity spending 50-60%
yeah,
on
definitely.
Overhead, and where maybe only 50-40% of the money they bring in goes to the actual cause. People don't mm-hmm. want to give to charities like that. So think about how you can create a charity that's going to be effective financially, and where you'll be able to direct
yeah.
most of the money you bring into the charity to the cause, and it really has to be about 80% or more. So that's another thing. I mean, I could go on and on with other things.
This is fascinating. We'll get to something else, Gene, for sure, but that, I mean, that's fascinating. People need to pick up your book for sure if they want to start a foundation or work with another foundation. You should be giving this to all the NFL athletes, Gene, or at least contacting them, say, because you don't understand how many foundations there are. Oh my gosh. Almost every NFL team has like 7 or 8 different people with different foundations. It's they're all over the place, and they sometimes don't have the right direction. So that's
yes, and then certain families have foundations, mm-hmm. and generally those foundations may be set up just to give out money.
Yeah.
And in the case of my husband and I, we have a very small family foundation, and we use that just to make donations. We don't have anyone on a payroll, but
okay.
we choose to make donations to different charities. And that's very different from a charity that's actually fundraising or bringing in money from other people.
So true. All right, so let's jump in. Sorry about that.
Sure, I just wanted to add that one of the things we're seeing now more than ever is consolidation of charities, meaning charities mm-hmm. are being acquired by other charities, because sometimes a very small charity is having a tough time making a profit or making ends meet or breaking even, and or their overhead's too high, and sometimes they'll be acquired by another charity who can actually take over their operations and do a better job than what they're doing. And I think running a charity or being involved in being the founder of a charity, it should not be about ego, but it should be about doing a great job.
Exactly.
Fulfilling a need.
Helping the others. Gene, one thing when I kind of evaluate
you. That's the key.
Yeah. One thing.
Helping our planet, helping with
exactly.
global warming, which is such a big issue right now. That's
yeah.
so important.
Now, what I was saying, Gene, was when I evaluate these different foundations of athletes I've interviewed or entertainers, I really see if they're really hands-on involved or they're not. And once you can kind of answer questions and see if they're firsthand right, you know, showing up every day to work or making sure that they when they bring it up as the only thing they do yet to playing their sport, you know for a fact they're putting a lot of time in. But then you need a team involved too, Gene, especially depending on the size of your foundation. Explain how important it is to have the team. Like, there's got to be a board of directors when you get a larger foundation. You need to basically also have certain people that you hire to do specific things, volunteers. As you said, a business. And that people need to get that training at times to be ready for that, right?
Yes, absolutely. Now, depending on, we could take a perfect example, take a charity with, bringing in $1 million a year. And that would mean, how do they bring in $1 million a year? Well,
yes.
Either the founder of that charity, if he's wealthy, could put in $1 million a year, or he would have to go out and fundraise. So how do you go out and fundraise? Well, if he could find volunteers to do that fundraising, that's one thing. But I caution anyone who's going to do volunteer fundraising for a charity, just make sure you know who you're doing it for and you've done your research on that charity. So going back to the $1 million annual budget for a charity, 20% should be spent on overhead,
10%
or less, that would be $200,000, and then $800,000 should go out to the programs of that charity.
Oh my, wow.
And so you'd have a budget of $200,000 to hire people,
mm-hmm.
and then maybe also to put on office expenses for everything, maybe putting on an event, a fundraiser. So you have to really watch your funds when you have your own charity.
Do you see sometimes, Jean, that they don't follow that 80-20 rule? Some charities out there?
Yes. I've seen it in a case more with some international charities where mm-hmm. they need to have an office, say, in maybe Paris, and then they need to have an office in New York, and it might be that the overhead goes up to maybe 30%. And in situations like that, I think they really have to, the charity has to be looked at case by case.
Definitely.
But in general, and then when a charity gets very big, say the budget's $100 million a year, that ratio might be 10% on overhead or 5% overhead, and then the rest to programs. And just as a percentage, it improves.
Interesting. Okay. Best place go ahead.
Oh, no, you go.
Okay. I was going to say, Jean, where can we purchase your book and learn more about you? Where can we go?
Yes. Successful Philanthropy, How to Make a Life by What You Give is available on Amazon.com, BarnesandNoble.com, and in selected bookstores across the United States. And I believe it will soon be available in Australia and England.
So your goal is not just for people.
I think on March 26th.
March 26th. Oh, great. Well, I was going to say, your goal is not just to be in the United States, all over the world, so that people could start foundations, charities, and help and give all over the world, especially if they have the means or the time, right?
Yes. Well, my book is actually intended to be an inspirational and practical guide. Now, in the book, there's not every answer to every question, but for someone who wants to get started or someone who's involved and wants to learn more, I think it's a good start. And I would encourage all of you really to take a look at the book. It's not expensive,
$15.
Absolutely. The ebook will be, I think, $9.99. And
great.
I'm hoping that I've been getting very positive feedback because the message is that we all have something
That's
to
great.
Offer, and what you have to offer is needed.
Okay, Jean, we do have to get running. Thanks again for calling, and take care, and I will definitely pass this on to different people mentioning your book when I interview different celebrity entrepreneurs and stuff like that are running foundations that they need to check out your book. So thanks for calling.
Well, thank you very much, Neil.
Take care,
Jean.
Okay. See you
Bye.
Later. Bye-bye. All right,
Thank
that was
you.
The Neil Haley Show. Take care, guys. Next week, some more exciting guests.